Today's lecture is one of a series of major public events named in honor of Professor George A. Miller, a noted mathematician who taught at the University of Illinois during the first half of the 20th century. He was a quiet and unassuming man, devoted to the university, and at his death in 1951, he left his estate to the campus, quote, to be used for educational purposes other than current general operating expenses. The estate showed that while he had always lived a simple, modest life, he had also been a very good investor. The estate amounted to nearly $1 million. That's in 1951, and $1 million was a lot of money. The Miller Committee series began shortly after that as one of several ways to honor Professor Miller's wishes. This is the final MillerCom lecture of the fall semester, spring semester schedule, which is filled with a number of fascinating events, will appear in the not distant future on the CAS website, Center for Advanced Study website. So go there for information. We also encourage you to sign up for the center's mailing list at cas.illinois.edu to keep up with all the events that are sponsored by the Center for Advanced Study. And you will also find us on Facebook and Twitter. Our event today is hosted by the International Program of the Illinois Fire Service Institute and is co-sponsored by a wide range of other campus units that you will see listed on the flyer that you were given as you came in. You'll see that there was quite a bit of interest across campus here. And we want to thank all of those units for their support. It is my honor and pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Professor Eugene Wang from Harvard University, where he is the Abby Aldrich Rockefeller Professor of Asian Art. His extensive publications cover the full range of Chinese art history, from very ancient and early art and archaeology to modern and contemporary art. And I even noticed an article listed down through there where he's talking about current cinema. So he has wide-ranging interests and expertise. He has received Guggenheim, Getty, and ACLS Reiskamp fellowships. His book, Shaping the Lotus Sutra, Buddhist Visual Culture in Medieval China, garnered the Academic Achievement Award in 2006 from Japan. He is the art history editor of the Encyclopedia of Buddhism and has served on the advisory board of the Center for Advanced Study of Visual Art, National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C., the Getty Foundation, the Li Qing Cultural and Educational Foundation in Taiwan, and the editorial board of the Art Bulletin. His current research is encompassing issues of visual programming, material forms of intelligence, and intersubjectivity effects. I had the good fortune to meet Eugene this summer at a conference in Dunhuang, China, concerning the Mogao Caves that he'll be discussing today, and also had the very good fortune to join him on a tour of several of the caves where he gave us all sorts of wonderful additional information about what we were seeing there. So please help me welcome Professor Eugene Wang.
Well, thank you very much, Wayne, for this very generous and nice introduction. And it's such a pleasure to be invited to this Miller Lecture. And I can't tell you how impressed I am by the wide range of sponsors who are sponsoring this event. And I want to thank all of them and all of you who support this. So today I'm going to talk about a very important subject, and sorry that you have to be in this grotto space when you have great beautiful sunshine outside, but cave is important, as important as we can think about the history of humankind. In other words, the whole entire human civilization starts in caves, and the history of art starts in caves, and intelligence, the mind, starts in caves. If you think about all these cave paintings that get the humankind into civilized states, and art and imagination and religion and all that. So I want to therefore start on that note, but get to a more specific kind of caves, that is the Buddhist caves, which has its own quality and disposition and character. Now, if we now look at the map of the world, at least part of the world, and think where the largest Buddhist cave complex are located, I would single out three of them, and these are, I would think, that the probably, arguably, the largest Buddhist cave complex with murals in it. And so you would have in Indian, Ajanta, and you would have, there's one here in Kucha, which is current Xinjiang province in northwest China, and there's a Denghuang, which is the focus today. And all of these three cave complexes, the Denghuang ranges, ranks as the largest in the number of caves featuring paintings and sculptures, and it has 492 caves with painted murals, with murals and spanning from the 4th to 14th century. So this is the largest art gallery in situ in the entire world. And so very impressive. But it's not just, so one of the takeaway advice I have, or moral I have, is that cave is not art gallery, even though I just now said that it's the largest art gallery in situ in the world, but it shouldn't be regarded as such, because in fact it's a special kind of space, and the paintings are displayed there for different purposes. And so just keep in mind, even though you may visit these caves as art galleries, but they're not actually primarily for visitors. So, and to give you a sense of the mystery and what is it that they're doing, I think the fundamental mystery about cave painting is that they're not to be seen, at least not to be seen in its entirety. And as you can see here, the photographers try to take picture of them. They have to use all kind of reflecting devices to get the picture captured. And in normal conditions, you could see part of the murals, but not all of them, right? So my opening question, therefore, is if the paintings, as we normally understand them to be, are to be seen, what is the point of painting or spreading the wall with the painting without having people necessarily to see them? So keep that in mind. And also, since we are going to have as I said, Denghuang in northwest China has 492 caves with murals. We can't go through all of them, obviously. So I will single out one that I think is fairly representative of the kind of cave art and go into deep analysis, or take you through that cave to see how the paintings are organized in a way that they add up to have some kind of meaning, and also what is the program, since you know I'm interested in programming of art. The cave consists of a number of walls with the paintings, but the thing is they all add up. They're not just isolated pieces unrelated to each other. In fact, they are very related to each other. So one way to give you a sense of how they add up to form a specific kind of program. Just think about this. If I put a Buddhist scholar who are familiar with the texts and put him in the cave and ask him to explain how all these paintings come together, he may identify particular paintings based on particular texts, but across the walls, these paintings have no reason to be together from the textual scholar's point of view, because there's no bibliographical information or taxonomy would explain why wall on the east wall and the west wall, the south wall, north wall, how are they related? So they would be basically clueless. So it is really for art historians like us, or myself. Well, that's I don't hope I don't think it's presumptuous to say that, but in fact, there's a logic, visual logic, to how these paintings would add up in a cave. So the one that I'm single out for today's discussion is Morgao Cave 254. Just a little basic information. Deng Huang actually has a few clusters of caves. So Morgao is the largest one. So sometimes when you refer to Deng Huang, you have in mind the Morgao Cave, but there are other cave complex there. So this cave is extraordinary, mainly because it gives us, I would show you, the entirety of meditation. So before we get to the program, I will just tell you the stories first and not worry about where, which painting is located where. And then we'll get to that later. So as you enter the cave, you will first face a central pillar, and then on the side walls, the side walls are covered with murals. So let's start with the four stories. The first story is Tigris story. And it talks about, or it shows three brothers that you can see here, one day on an outing. And they notice that there's a hungry tigress about to starving to death, mainly because she couldn't feed the young cubs. So out of great compassion, the youngest of the three brothers decided to save the starving tigress, and he won. In order to do so, he climbed onto a cliff and basically threw himself down on the cliff, onto the ground, in order to save the, or feed himself to the hungry tigress so that she can eat him and then feed the young cubs. And somehow the starving tigress is so emaciated and weakened that she couldn't quite eat him. So he climbs onto the cliff again and using a bamboo stick to pierce his neck so that the blood oozes out, and he then dives again, and then the tigress drinks the blood, and then with strength gained, the tigress eats up the man. So, and that's what is happening here, and you could see the young prince reclining, and then the tigress gnawing into his body. And then all these other young cubs start to converge on him as well. And that caused, of course, a considerable panic to the young to the brothers, who hastened home to tell their mother that their brother has just sacrificed himself to the hungry tigress. And the mother, of course, is in deep grief, as you can see here. And they gather the bones of the brother's body and then put him in a tower, in a stupa tower, and thereupon the end of the story. And the story, of course, ends in a way that is expected in Buddhist genre, known as Jataka, that is Buddha's former lives. All the Jataka stories are Buddha's former lives, and they all end with the same closure, which is the person, that person was me, meaning that that person was one of my former lives, meaning Shakyamuni's former lives. All right. So that's the first story. Oh, that's the tower that they built to enshrine his bones. Right. Second story, King Sibi, or King Sibi. So it concerns a king named Sibi, who is known for his compassion disposition. And then two celestial rulers decided that they want to test the level of his compassion. So one of them disguised as a dove, the other as a hawk. The hawk chases the dove, and they come to the vicinity of the king. And basically, as you can see here, he holds the dove, and the dove pleads him to save his life, or else he will be eaten up by the hawk. And the hawk made his plea as well, saying that since you are compassionate, how can you not take compassion on me? If I don't eat this dove, I'm going to die. So here's your choice. So apparently the king, being a compassionate person, faces a dilemma. Who should he choose? And in the end, he said, okay, the only way out of this dilemma is that I offer a portion of my flesh, and you can gouge the amount of flesh equal to the weight of the dove, and I can trade that with you, and you let the dove go. And so he jumped himself, so a scale was laid out, and so the one inexplicable thing happened, that is, no matter how much flesh is gouged out, put on the scale, it never equals the weight of the hawk. So in the end, the compassionate king threw himself onto the scale and said, basically, take my body and let the dove go. And then the hawk essentially reappears as Indra, the ruler of heaven. They say, I'm just kidding. Yeah. The third story is the defeat of Mara. By the way, now you know the ending. I already told you. This is another Jataka story, and it ends obviously with that was me in my previous life, Shakyamuni. Right. So now switch gear to another genre called a Buddha's life story, because the previous two stories are Buddha's former lives, and now we deal the third and fourth stories are Buddha's life episodes from Buddha's life. So the young prince Siddhartha, as the story goes that preceded this episode, is that he grew up in a wealthy family, and he went out and observed old age, sickness, death, and monk, and he feels like, why is it that we all end up in this kind of miserable form? Therefore, he goes about searching for truth, and eventually decides that he wants to leave this wealthy household in search of the great truth that can lift, deliver him out of the cycles of suffering and so forth. So by this stage, essentially, he kind of found he practiced austerity and so forth. In the end, he kind of found the way to out of the human suffering. So that was the moment when he decides that he wants to meditate deeply and will gain, is on the verge of gaining enlightenment. At that point, the ruler of the realm of desire named Mara decide to intervene, because Mara sees that this young man is going to leave or transcend the realm of desire. And so he decides to intervene. And so here's a scene when a young prince is about to enter into meditation, and then Mara the demonic king sends his demonic army in an assault, try to distract him, as you can see, all these. And he stays firm, undeterred and undistracted. And so that military action didn't work, and then Mara assorted to a different strategy. So he sends three beautiful women, his daughter essentially, try to seduce the young prince. And the young prince reduced them to three old hacks, basically show that the human beauty, female beauty, and all that beautiful thing on earth are going to pass, and nothing stays forever. And one should see through the appearance of beauty and see the reality. And in fact, it's very meaningful that they also have a skeleton next to these old hacks, just to show that eventually human condition is going to come to this. And also, this is also meaningful because this is in Buddhist literature, it is called white bone, and the meditation, the contemplation on white bone itself is part of the meditation exercise. So it's very, it's for good reason that you have the white bone showing up here. So that's the famous defeat of Mara. And so with this, of course, Mara was defeated, and the young prince went on his way at attaining enlightenment. And then that brings us to the fourth story, that is the Great Awakening or Enlightenment. And here we show a Buddha, and he is now becoming a Buddha, and he is actually, so you see two figures standing in water, making offerings to him. And these are two merchants named Chapusha and Balika, who were passing by and noticed that this man is in deep meditation, and then and there's a sort of a little story before this, because Siddhartha, now Shakyamuni, initially practiced meditation with learning from old teacher, and they taught him how to get to four different meditative heavens. So he found that practice of that austerity is too extreme, in the sense that you have to starve yourself almost to the point of complete emaciation, and he saw that wasn't very good. So he decided to take a middle road. So up to that point, he had tried sensuality, the life of desire that he experienced in the royal palace. And then he left the royal palace and in search of truth, and then he went to the other extreme, that is practice austerity, and almost starving himself to death. And he found that too is too much, too extreme. So he finally decided that he would opt for the middle road, which is that he doesn't need to starve him to death, but still practice this meditation. So thereupon, he needs food. And then these two men offer him food, milk rice. And so thereupon, he eats, and these two men then become the first lay disciple of the Buddha. And it's also interesting that maybe not a coincidence that the Chapusha, one of the man's name also means non-returner, which means that meaning that they're detached from the realm of desire, so it is probably for that reason that there's embedded sort of non-returner in one of those men, and meaning that they are on their way towards meditative enlightenment and not returning. And also we learn that meditation practice involves nurturing a process. That is, the trope often is some kind of seed that blossoms into a tree, a plant. In other words, this organic process. is analogous to the meditative nourishment of the mind. So you therefore, next to the water, you will have the tree that keeps growing, and it's part of that process. And I mentioned that there's a sense, embedded sense of detached from the realm of desire, and then it's for good reason that at the two corners of the composition, you show a young man being led away from a beautiful woman, and that's clearly to show that, you know, it's a way of getting detached from the realm of desire. And as one progresses in this steps of meditation, one gets to the, eventually, of course, the idea is that you go to a cave to meditate. And here you see the three figures in meditation, and you could see actually there's implied progress going on. They all enter as young men, they eventually, it takes a long time, so they grow beard, right? So there's a sort of time passes. There's also a different stage, a different steps implied. Initially there's a flame, and that flame is extinguished with water, and ultimately it's the smoke that kind of puts out the flame. in other words, according to some manual, that meditation has a number of steps. The final two steps is the meditation by water and smoke. Water and vapor that puts out the flame. All right. So that's the idea probably implied here. So as one meditates, of course, one then feels that you're kind of out of the body, and with that, there's this, often in the description that whoever meditates, the Buddha especially, and his followers, were able to levitate. So you could see that he's levitating, so suspended in mid-air, as you can see there, right? So I will give you a little schematic account of the meditation, and these are the, so meditation involves, as the literature tells us, four levels of trance. It is also known as the four meditative heavens. And it is said that once you attend that level of meditation, you also gain six super knowledges or six supernatural powers. And one of them is levitation, as you can see. Now, okay, so we've, thus far, we've told four stories, and now let's see how these four stories are mapped out in the cave. And as you, so all these Mogao caves are entered from the east, so as you enter from the east, south wall, north wall, and you push towards the, and the west wall, all right. So that's how this program is laid out. Now, if you examine the program closely, the distribution of the narrative, there are immediately two very puzzling things come up. One is that, why is it that the Buddha's life, since you know there's a strict symmetry between these, then you know it's organized along a central axis, and the central axis pushes forward. And if that's the case, then in terms of timeline, the design seems got the timeline wrong, because you start with the Buddha's previous life. That previous life leads to his life. How come that here you reverse the order? You start with the Buddha's life, and then you have the previous life following the Buddha's life. And that, at the outset, doesn't seem to make sense. Right? So that's the first perplexing fact or problem we face. The second problem is Buddha's life, as you can see, consists of a number of episodes. And here's the table of contents of the second century Buddha's life story. And then you can see it starts with a birth, and the number of very dramatic, interesting episodes going all the way. So, but we start with number 13 and 14. And again, the question is why? That doesn't seem to make sense. So essentially, our real inquiry starts with these two questions. Why reverse the order of putting the life before the previous life? And why also leapfrog all these episodes and cut to the chase all the way to defeat of the Mara, right? Now, one of the things, if you recall, that occurs, because also this is the North Wall, and we were talking, that's our fourth story, the Enlightenment story, and that's the Jataka tale, and you enter from east. So this is a moment of enlightenment. Now, if you recall that when you have the moment of enlightenment, these things happen. You attain the six super knowledges, super knowledges. And we talk about levitation. And another thing we're told is that with that meditation, you have attained the divine eye. The divine eye essentially means that it's not a normal human eye, pair of eyes. It's the sort of eyes that transcends human limitation. And it comes down essentially to those two. One is that it allows you to see things in a panoramic way, so that you see almost like a God's eye, see things from the beginning to the end in a way that human eye couldn't. I'll talk about another in a minute. So to some extent, the cave is organized in a way to allow to have that purview. So as you enter the cave, you will first see this Buddha image facing you. And next to him, as you can see here, there's these two very strange, weird-looking figures. And one actually holds a dove. Another holds a skull. But you can't see here. You have to take my word. And then I can prove it, actually. That's the case. So this pair of figures often flank some kind of niche, gate, and some kind of threshold, a moment. And here's an example. From Metropolitan Museum, you have the stele. And the stele has a Buddha, and then these two figures, one holding a skull. They switch the position, but it's the same pair. You're holding a skull and holding a dove. As you can see here, holding a skull, holding a dove. And then in a Yingang, cave 9, and that you will have the same figure holding a skull, holding a dove, but flanking the doorway of this is called a bright window, but you know, essentially some kind of entrance way. So who are these figures? Well, to make long story short, they are each has its own particular quality and capacity. One is said, the one with a dove is said to have some kind of past deeds that involved the killing of animals and then eventually repented, stopped that killing, and then thereby goes from hell to heaven. And another holding the figure holding the skull basically says that this man has an unusual gift. He would pick a skull from a funerary ground or cemetery, and then he would be able to tell you what sort of past deeds that led to the death of this person. And then reading the skull, he would be able to tell you which of the six paths of rebirth this being is going to head towards. So if you add them together, oh, by the way, there's not a single Buddhist text that would put these two figures in one text. All right, this is really the artist's contrived way of making these two figures as a pair. And essentially, I think what it does is to show that, in fact, these two figures give you the whole span of previous life, past and future, that is the future of future scenario rebirth. And just to give you a little bit more of how they are situated in context, you could see that this figure here points to this gateway, and this is the where you see the elephant rider, which in Buddhism just means someone, or actually a Shakyamuni, who's initially in heaven, and he entered his mother's womb, so riding an elephant. That the riding on the elephant is, in the Buddhist iconography, means that someone is entering Maya's womb, the mother's womb. In fact, there's a very interesting article about how that figure in heaven contemplates on entering the womb, and the question is, which womb should I enter? Right. And then this is the lotus scene showing rebirth, and so you could see that this entranceway is really where life and death seem to converge, and it's a very meaningful place. Therefore, you would have the person holding the skull, holding the dove. They all point to past deeds and future rebirth. All right. So if you keep that in mind, then you kind of understand the divine eye, what it sees. It sees the whole lifespan, you know, past the future. And so in terms of and that's typically what it says in Buddhist Sutra whenever it tells us what it means to have the divine eye. To have the divine eye is that you can see all human beings, all sentient beings caught up in this cycles of birth and rebirth. You see the whole span. So that's what the eye, divine eye, can see. So that's one of the, and so that's the, in other words, having the divine eye is to see that magnitude of the life cycles. And it also means that once you have that kind of knowledge, you can also see your former lives. So in fact, the very moving moment in Buddhist narrative is that when Shakyamuni attained enlightenment, all his previous life start to flash through his mind, and it's almost like he's playing that interior movie, and all these previous lives start to show up and pass through his eyes. And if you keep that in mind, that this ability includes the ability to recall former lives, then if you look at how the paintings are arranged, you now understand, because this is the moment of great awakening, and this is a meditation moment. And once you start in getting to the meditation, you attain that super knowledge, and once you have the super knowledge, you recall your previous lives, right? In this case, his previous life, and that includes King Sipi giving up his body to a dove, and so on. So therefore, this order, the reverse order, is actually a device to show that, in fact, this is a moment of recall. All right. As you can see here, it goes this way, and this is an enlightenment scene, and this is previous life, something that flashes, passes through his eyes. Right. So, and we talked about that the meditation involves four levels of trance, or four levels of meditative heaven. To give you an idea how this is mapped out in Buddhist cosmology, here's a diagram, and you can see Buddhist cosmology consists of this vertical ascent, and essentially dividing the realms into three, that the lower one is the realm of desire, and you get to the realm of form, and you get to the realm of formlessness. And that's where you would have the four heavens, of the four meditative heavens, or four kinds of trance. And here's a illustration, but kind of nicely picturing the four meditative heavens as four little babies, but you get the point, right? So that's what the Buddhist meditation is about. And also that shows what is Buddhist cosmology is about. So this is one of the most important facts about Buddhist culture, that is, in that scheme, cosmology is psychology, right? Buddhist cosmology is Buddhist psychology. You cannot just divorce one from the other. You have to imagine one in terms of the other, and that's the whole point, right? To some extent, this is not really about cosmology. It's a way about the progression of the mind. And here's a list of how you go through that progression. You go from the first meditative heaven, second, third, fourth, and then you get to the limited space, you get the limitless consciousness, and then you feel nothingness, and then you feel the state where the thought and thoughtlessness no longer can be distinguished, and then you start to think about, and this is the hardest part, it's a sort of almost like a extinction of everything. And then end up with the flaming, and as I said earlier, contemplation by water and vapor that just dissolve everything, right? Now, sure enough, after we're done with these two things, you could see these four niches, they actually signify the four meditative heaven, right? Would be here. These four meditative heavens. And you could see that inside there's a seated Buddha in either doing this or doing the meditation alternatively, but there's also an alternation of flame, right? Presumably some smoke, flame, and so on. But also meaningfully, you could see that on the side, all these like seeds, plants start to blossom. As I mentioned earlier, the meditation involved this biological process of a seed blossoming into a full-blown plant, and that is happening here. Right? And in a way, you could see that we started with these meditative figures in the cave, then they kind of progress. And finally, we get to the end of the journey and the climatic moment of meditation, where it is said that whenever you reach that stage, all of a sudden you see the whole room filled with Buddha, thousand Buddhas. And also, more importantly, there's a cartouche attached to each of the Buddha, and through careful research, scholars have found that all these Buddhas to the left of this wall are the southern Buddha of the past Kalpa. Kalpa means eons of years, all right? It just means zillion. I mean, in Buddhist numerology, a number doesn't matter. It just means a lot. Okay, so southern Buddhas of the past and thousands of Buddhas of the future. And also, this is one of the most confining things about this cave, is that this very view, no living being can actually have this view. Because there's no place you could actually stand and aim your camera and capture this. This is not captured by camera. This is stitched together by thousand photographs. In other words, no living eye has ever laid on this as in real place, all right? Because it was blocked by the center pillar in front of it, which is kind of mind-boggling if you come to think about it, right? But in any case, the point is that when you reach this state, this essentially means that this Buddha is situated between neither here nor there, neither past nor future. It's in that point where time no longer is relevant for this particular position, right? Which means you could say that eternity, you could say nirvana, you could, you know, all those things. But that's the point you want to try to get, all right? So to fully understand what's going on, West Wall, I need to give you a sense of how it stands in relation to the central pillar. And only can you, only when you grasp the import of the central pillar can you fully understand what is going on at the back wall. So this is the Buddha, how it looks in the niche. And then this is the Buddha on the back of the wall. And they obviously look very different. In other words, the question is, they're both Buddhas, why they look so different? And what's the sort of overtone or meaning of all this? So essentially, let's see. To understand that, we need to actually go to Ajanta, to the Indian prototype, to fully understand what's going on here. Now, in the Indian case, in this Ajanta, basically you have the cave temple have two type of plans or two type of cave temple. One is called a vihara, where the monks would have their cells and presumably for meditation, and they will gather there. So there's no structure in the middle. And then there's a called a chacha, where you have a space that ends with a stupa inside the cave temple. So these are the two plans and types that the Dunhuang cave draws upon to make its own kind of design. And as you can see here, this is Ajanta cave, and that's a chacha, which is something like this. And you could see that Dunhuang design takes after this, but makes a big change of this. And we'll see why that's the case. So what the structure inside the temple about is the stupa form, which is essentially meaning architectural tumulus, that is the barrel of Buddha's bones and relics. You might just regard it simply as a tomb, all right, a tumulus. Initially, when they make the Buddha's tumulus, they wouldn't make Buddha's image because they feel like Buddha is not to be pictured as a human form, and therefore it's the stupa itself stands for the Buddha. And eventually, they decided they want to put the figure in as Buddha to show that, in fact, he passed away, but he's still with us. And so that's one of the, but of course there's a complicated issue there here about how the Greek influence came to Central Asia and to India and then changed that landscape. But that's another story. But the point is to say initially it has no Buddha image, and gradually they would have Buddha image on the stupa. So you could see that this is essentially the Indian way of treating this great narrative, this entry into nirvana, where Buddha has passed away, but he is still with us in his iconic form. And you could also see how the same kind of concern is mapped onto a different cave site, which is the Kizo in Central Asia, where it's a drive towards the nirvana, where they actually see the Buddha reclining in great extinction. And then in order to somehow make this less of a closure, because you could see all different cultures try to come up to terms with this fact that the Buddha has departed. And that wouldn't be very encouraging when you think about them, if they make too much out of this Buddha's departure or entering the nirvana. That's not very encouraging to human still living, because you want somehow to be related to the Buddha. In fact, one of the they try to find different ways of livening this or lightening this sad fact. So in the case of Indian design, they will put Buddha image still doing the preaching, thereby showing that yes, his remain might be buried inside the tumulus, but he is still preaching and still there. And in the Central Asian example, you could see that, yes, he's passed into Nirvana, but somehow, as we can see, that they will actually make a great comeback in the way that this is the entrance, this is the end of the cave, so they would have a sun close to the entrance, a moon close to the Nirvana place, so meaning that, okay, you would have life going into darkness, into night, where the sun sets, sunrise, life, sunset, or sunrise, Nirvana, death, sunset. But in order to somehow give an open-endedness of this sad fact, they make a circle or make a cycle. So what they do is that they present Buddha flying the air from the darkness all the way to the sun, meaning that some being or Buddha is coming back and contemplating descending into our world again, so thereby making a cycle, which actually is contradictory to the Buddhist doctrine, because Buddhist doctrine is that Nirvana is actually a permanent delivery from the human cycle of birth or rebirth. But you can see that the lay communities, when they make images, of course they don't always toe the doctrinal line. They have to make images meaningful to their daily life and their concern with life and death. So this is how they would do it, in other words, making paradoxically Buddha come back again from death, right, and flying back and contemplating birth again. And so we were talking about how this would map out the drive towards Nirvana, and then there's a comeback, and then here would be the prince in heaven contemplating descent into the human world. And that figure at the entranceway is placed in the Dunhuang cave to the central pillar, where this is the prince in heaven contemplating descending into the human world. And once he does so, then the cycle continues on and on. All right. So, and another, so you could see, therefore, the Dunhuang design make interesting change over this cha-cha, and by making it linking to heaven and also making the comeback possible, right? And it, so this is Dunhuang, this is Ajanta. It also appropriates the vihara form, because unlike this this ground plan, the Dunhuang cave more or less look like this in terms of the rectangular plan, and they would make something very interesting toward the end of it. In the Indian design, toward the very end of the room, you would have another little sanctuary at the back of the room, and there. And in that inner sanctuary, you would have Buddha still preaching. So the idea is that, okay, he's still doing the preaching. Now, if you look at the Chinese case, is that they take the idea, all right, and they make a mock niche. It's a fictional, pictorial, simulated niche that is essentially a pictorial fiction. It just to show that, yes, there's a recess, except that the recess is not there. So the point I'm making is, this is a very clever solution to a problem. You want the Buddha, you want to acknowledge the Buddha passing into Nirvana, who is no longer there, but you also want to make a point that he is still with us, present. In other words, you essentially have to want to have he can eat it. In other words, showing that he's absent, has departed, but also showing that he's with us here. And the way to do it is to paint it, make a fictional presence of this niche, which you can say it's there, it's not there. You can say it's there, but it's not there. And in fact, the kind of story they draw on is that in Afghanistan, there's this so-called shadow cave, which completely fascinated Chinese popular imagination. It said that there was a cave where there was a poisonous dragon, which was a problem for the local communities, and then the Buddha came and suffocated the dragon in the cave. And then Buddha's about to leave, and the dragon says, please do not leave, because I will revert back to my evil ways. And Buddha said, what can I do? You have to stay. But Buddha said, okay, I will stay. And upon that, he leaps into the wall and stayed there as an image. So that's a famous shadow cave. Essentially, they said that, well, he's departed, but he stayed as an image. Right? So that's the idea being drawn here. Right? So, and also this way of draping the Buddha is actually to say that this is a Buddha that is normally attributed to showing the ancient Buddha, Buddha of the past. So already the pastness is already featured here, is a Buddha of the past. And then there's another interesting aspect. This is unpainted, this is uncolored. So some scholars initially wrongly characterize it as a white world Buddha. It's not a white world. It actually means colorless, meaning that when Buddha from the past appears, he appears in this resplendent, radiant form. And that dazzling form itself has no color. It's pure light. Now, so all this is to say that this is the image you don't get to see normally, because and essentially we all live in an age when Buddha has passed into Nirvana, so we don't see him. So if you read all these Buddhist narratives, the great chagrin and pain expressed is often that, Buddha, you are the guardian light to us. You open up our eyes, and therefore we can navigate this darkness of our human world with suffering and all that. And I've just begun to get it, and as I'm getting it, now you leave me, you abandon me, leaving me to all the darkness from this point on. How can you do that, right? And the Buddha essentially says, look, all the Buddhas in the past have passed into Nirvana. All the Buddhas in the future have passed into Nirvana. Why should I make any difference? And upon that he leaves. Then, acknowledging that condition, then it becomes a standard line in Buddhist literature, basically to say that, okay, how do we get to the Buddha? And the solution is meditation. If you meditate, you will see the Buddha image as a dream image. And then, in order to show the rarity of this kind of image, you could see, therefore, it's resplendent. It also has all the great marks of an extraordinary person. Like, for instance, he had this cobweb, like a duck cobweb in the finger, right? And so, and also the point is that you don't normally see this kind of image. If you do, that means your meditation has succeeded. You see, you caught this rare glimpse of the Buddha, all right? So, and that explains why these two are widely different. This is the Buddha contemplating entering into this human world, and this is the one that is already in the past, but now made manifest in the present. All right. So this whole scene, therefore, is a visionary testimony, or the testimony of the success of vision. Meditating tend to give you this, like if you see 1,000 Buddhas filling up the room, if you catch a sight of the resplendent form of the Buddha, that means you succeeded
in meditation, all right? And also the fact that you are also in the midst of, in a state that is neither past nor future. It's a state that defines time and space. Right? Just to give you an idea how the actual repentance instruction, or maybe just one last note about this. So, okay. So why do people then meditate in Buddhist culture in medieval times? It's actually, well, now they would like to think, of course, it's spiritual pursuit and all that. It's very nice to think that way. But we also have to be a little bit more historical about this. In other words, for the lay community to be very vested in meditation in medieval China and elsewhere, there's a good purpose. And it actually has to do with how they would imagine to get out of their daily life, the woes and suffering and problems. So let's say if you, your brother is sick in medieval China, and the first knee-jerk reaction is that, okay, there must be something that he, in his previous life, misdeeds, sinful deeds that he committed in his previous lives, and that led to this present disease. So, but how do we know what kind of misdeeds he did? Well, the Buddhist literature actually never specified that. Basically, said we don't know because we all live in this collective life. So there's no way knowing. So for Buddhism, the way out of this is to, how do? Repent. We repent, and how do you repent? Visualize. It's as simple as that. If you visualize your past sins, you will get out of that problem. Now, how do I know what kind of sin I did in my previous life? The Buddhist literature, therefore, actually never says, well, you have to really think about what you did. It's all about shared human experience. So, therefore, up to 15th century, all the Buddhist literature on repentance build on only one shared narrative or scenario. Because it's very different from the Catholic repentance where you have to really confess your sinful deeds. In Buddhism, you never confess your individual deeds. It's all the collective human misdeeds that will cause the problem. And so we don't have to sort out who did what. All we need is just repent on this collective level. And then with that, hopefully, we can get out of a problem. So it's for that reason, therefore, there's a great deal of repentance going on. And with the repentance, there's a great deal of visualization going on. And therefore, this cave essentially gives you the whole program of visualization. And that, in part, answers the question I raised earlier, why they paint a repentant of the visualization on the cave wall without having necessarily to look at it. Because the common literature or scholarly wisdom now, which I'm not sharing, is that this kind of meditative scenes painted on the wall are the visual aids for visualization. And I don't think that's right. Because if you read closely the Buddhist literature, there's not a single literature that tells you that in order to practice meditation, you need to look at the painting on the wall. It's never spelled out that way. So therefore, then the question is, okay, if you're encouraged to meditate, but you're not required to look at the painting on the wall, what are these paintings on the wall for, right? And so here's my theory. And I think what they do is that it's an automated process. So what they paint on the wall is that, okay, this work, this great work of repentance is being done. And it continues to be done, it has been doing, it's continuing to be done. And hopefully good things will come out of it as this program runs on its own. So in a way, I would say it's a sort of automated a meditation process that goes on and on and on. And you can lock this cave door and not letting in the audience, but it will still do its work. So that's my solution to this problem.
And just I would end with this record or this description of how the repentance ritual goes. It gives you all the different things you need to do. You contemplate the image, meaning that you don't have to look at it, but you can think about the image. And you confess, you pay homage, you prostrate yourself on the ground and cry, and you concentrate with eyes closed and imagine, and you are in and out of this meditative absorption. See, when you meditate, you actually close your eyes, right? And then once you close your eye, you imagine you're in this meditative absorption, you start to see images, that meaning actually your inner eye start to see images, and you imagine a room filled with the Buddhas, right? And then you burn incense, you make vow, you repent, and so on. And in the end, there's a concentration, visualize Buddha and the cosmos. You visualize Buddha and the cosmos filled with the Buddhas. So next time you do meditation, try this. Thank you.
Professor Wong has offered to answer some questions for a few minutes.
Yeah.
Oh, we have a microphone coming around so that we're recording the lecture.
I wanted to thank you for your talk. You presented pretty much of a more intellectual art history sort of view of these caves. And I was wondering if anyone has actually talked to practicing Buddhist priests about their interpretation of the purpose of the caves, the meaning of the caves from an actual inward spiritual practice sort of view. Now, my understanding is that China has pretty well eradicated Buddhist priests from their territory, but I'm wondering if there are ones in, like Dalai Lama or other people in exile who would know what the purpose of the caves had been from an actual inward spiritual development perspective.
Thank you. That's a very good question. We have to acknowledge there's great distance, historical distance, a gap between what is the practice going on now and what's the medieval 5th century, 6th century kind of practice were like back then. So there's that issue. And then also there's the issue of the nature of these caves, and from what literature we know, these were not Buddhist monasteries. These were actually the sort of, memorial spaces and shrines, Buddhist shrines made by lay community, and they are far away from the settlements or from towns, and they're not that frequently used, and therefore we know from what literature we had that they would have certain kind of rituals, but it's not the sort of the thing that you just described. In other words, it was some kind of concern about family issues, problems, someone just dead, someone being remembered and cure the disease and so on and so forth. So there is, of course, a spiritual content in this, and I don't deny that. And we value these paintings mainly for the spiritual content. They document for us that pursuit for enlightenment and so forth. But as we all know, the culture is complicated, right? So the lay communities may have their own agenda, but in doing so, they also give us this great art with great spiritual import that even nowadays, when we have spiritual aspirations, we can still relate to this process. But we also need to acknowledge the fact that the original purpose probably would not this high-minded. They were probably addressing their more immediate concerns. These are two different kind of issues, but we want to keep all these in view. Yeah, but thank you for excellent question. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Again, thank you for the presentation. I just have two very short questions. When were these caves discovered? And how is the Chinese government acting to protect them? I mean, can anybody go through them, or do you need special permission?
Yeah, well, it was a good question. I mean, it was discovered in the beginning of 20th century by foreigners, actually. The French and the British, the Hungarians, the Russians, and so forth. I mean, it was out there, and people these foreigners discovered it, and then they actually took away a lot of stuff from the cave. So a lot of manuscripts and painting, school paintings, there was this secret library that they discovered, and so they went to the secret library and then took tons of manuscripts to Paris, to London, and to Harvard as well. So now it's a World Heritage Site, and it's taken care of very well. And you can visit, and everyone can visit. It's a normal procedure. You just make arrangement and go there. You go online making reservations and go to visitor center, and they will take you to the cave. So not all of them are open for conservation reasons, but a fair amount of them are open to the public. And yes, you're most welcome to visit. And in summertime is a peak time to try to avoid the summertime, because a lot of people go in there. And if you go now, actually it's relatively, it's less populated, so it's easier.
Thank you for the lecture. That's fascinating. And I have one simple question, might be naive. Since there are more, as you described, like a ceremonial commemorative caves, and did the sponsors, the financial sponsors, the creators, had any influence on the images, the stories?
Thank you. That's a question we all try to grapple with, because the kind of information we have is limited. We can only infer how much influence they may have. The more we study, the more we feel like probably they're not necessarily directly involved in the actual design. It's not like designing your own house and you kind of get your drawing done and dictate to the architect what you want to do. So what literature we have tend to be that, if they're really wealthy, they say, we want the latest design, and we want the best craftsman. That information you often have. They actually, in the inscription, they always say, you know, for this cave, we have the best ever craftsman hired. And then I have a sense that they kind of just leave it to them to work. And also we have a sense that some of the aristocrats coming to this part of the country came from the central plain, major metropolitan regions such as Luoyang and so forth. And so they brought the new design with them, so that all of a sudden, like this cave, it's clear that it came from the central plain. With these newly arrived aristocratic families, and actually some of them were like officials, and they were kind of lost out in the power struggle. But they were royal family members, so they were kicked out to the northwest, where they kind of, but they brought the new design with them. Yeah.
Just curious, in terms of the images, Are they primarily focused on images of the Supreme Buddha, or do you see images of the other Buddhas, other cave images of the Budai that have been documented or noted for?
Yeah, well, this is still a stage before the arrival of the Mahayana. So this is still pretty much concentrated on the singular Shakyamuni Buddha, but as probably a half or so century later, there's a new movement. That's a sort of Mahayana movement when they created more Buddhas. But given that, actually, it's if you look at the back of the wall, the west wall, already that's a thousand Buddhas. That already is the seat of the future development. In other words, the idea is that this Shakyamuni Buddha is one, just one of the many Buddhas. And you can see that back of the wall, the west wall, it's overwhelming presence of the Buddha, the both past and future. And he's just one of them. So that then that impulse got developed half a century or so later. And then you have lots of other Buddhas different names and different territories and different functions. Yeah, but that's yet to come. Yeah.
So thank you for giving us this lecture. And actually, I have visited Moga Cave this summer, and your lecture really enriched that experience. I was wondering.
Did you visit this cave?
Not this specific cave, but I visited like a couple like 9 or 10 caves.
Okay.
Yeah, because the cave like open was very limited at that time.
Right.
Yeah. But I was wondering like who designed this cave? Like, you see like for different walls, there actually like images. They look like they're unrelated, but you know like to present art like a it's like kind of meditation. You have the story of the Buddha and the timeline is reversed to its past life. So is the like graphical programming is like done by a Buddhist master or someone else who designed it to put all this stuff together?
Yes. Yeah, well, that's a question we all try to answer, but we don't have information. But it doesn't bother me because I feel like, you know, we are in this day and age, we often talk about distributed intelligence. We have computer science professors here. I mean, I'm climbing onto that bandwagon as well. I think a lot of time it's the sort of collective intelligence and the community of creators who will probably have input into the design of this. So you could actually, on the basis of what the sort of programming kind of programming goes on there, you could actually infer their knowledge, their cultural background, their level of literacy, their immersion in Buddhism, and all that. So the profile you have is a sort of some kind of mind with certain qualities, and I don't care who specifically which individual designed it, but all I care is that I want to have a grasp of their knowledge base, their horizon, their cognitive capacity, their intelligence, level of intelligence. And at the end of the day, that's all that matters.
Thank you.
Thank you.